Church,
oh, it's on now. I would like to introduce to you, to those that don't know her, our pianist here is Gail Rothus. An answer to, a prayer that we've had. She's going to join us as our pianist. She is, many of you know her. She used to be associated with Faith Fellowship, I believe. Or New Haven United Methodist, back when it was, and Harrison. So she has some history with our church, so I want you all to give her a warm Miami Whitewater welcome. We do have several announcements. Remember the anniversary party today for Keith and Loretto Hart. Saturday is our church meeting. That is a very important meeting. We've been praying for how many days? 77 days we've been wearing our bracelets and praying for our church. And we're going to come together Saturday and talk about where we're going and how we're going to get there and what our vision is. So that is Saturday at 11 o'clock. We will have lunch provided so you won't starve. But I'm not going to say how long we'll be here. It'll be when God lets us out of here. At the end of the service, Rita is going to be standing in the back of the church for you to drop your loose change into the big baby bottle. We have to turn that in this week, and we would really like to return it full. So please remember that. If you want little ones, we do have more little ones in the office. Yeah, if you have them, bring them in next week. Is that right? That's good. Chair Volleyball Wednesday. And yes. And don't forget our Meyer Simply Give program that we are participating in with Meyer. There's details in the bulletin. And a reminder for all you Lightning Squad helpers, we start back up this week. Wednesday, we will be over at Whitewater Elementary. And Thursday, we will be at Crosby with Piper. She's excited about it. So please put those on your calendars. If you haven't been there to help us, you are still welcome to come and join us. Just touch base with Rita, Robin, Chris, or myself, and we'll give you all the information. Are there any other announcements that I missed? All right. Then let's stand and join me with our call to worship. Joyful, joyful, we adore thee. A Savior has been born.
He is the God of glory and the Lord of love, a wellspring of joy of living.
Come, let us worship him.
Let us offer our gifts of praise to the King of Bethlehem.
And if you could remain standing for our opening hymn, Joyful, Joyful, We Adore Thee. And I want you guys to pay attention. We will have a short intro. We're used to a longer intro, so this will be short. So catch up.
Thank you.
job, congregation. So we have a group up here called the, we haven't really came up with a name, but that's just for today, the Joyous Singers, the Glory Singers. So anybody who would like to come and just kind of sit in this area, we're going to depend on you all just for guiding us in our worship, okay? So these are the Joyous Singers up here, all right? We're all joyous singers. So thank you all for helping us out in that area. So we want to welcome those who are watching online. It's good to have you. It's a happy new year. And we come now to the time in our service where we recognize birthday celebrations or anniversary celebrations. Do we have any today? Birthday or anniversary? I know we have. Yeah, we have an anniversary party. Where's your wife? I know where she is. That's exactly where she is. So it's Loretto's and Keith's anniversary today.
But it can't be 50 years. I told you last week, I felt like it's 17.
Oh, 17. Well, what a great compliment. That's great. So I guess we'll pray for you and Loretta. Loretto, I hope she will feel the love as well. Gracious and loving God, we give thanks for Loretto and Keith for their marriage of 50 years. What a testimony, Lord. I ask that you will continue to surround them with your love. I pray, God, that each and every day they will cherish one another and care for each other. Be with them today in their celebration. May it be a joyous occasion. We give you thanks for this marriage, and we ask it that it will be held in your hands for many years to come. In Jesus' name, amen.
Amen.
All right, so now, any children, would you like to come up? All right. John. So, this morning, Happy New Year, by the way. This morning, I want to talk to the congregation about the wise men. You see them up there, or they're called the Magi. And when the Magi came, they came later to visit Jesus, and they brought him gifts. Now, some of you weren't here on Christmas Eve, so I have a video. Some of you have seen it, but I want you to watch this video about this little girl who receives a gift, okay?
Open it.
That's all I did.
Yeah. This is going to be your favorite present.
What is it?
Excited over a gift of broccoli? You would? You like broccoli? No, you don't like broccoli? But I can tell you were excited when you got this gift, right? Yeah, so when we get gifts, we feel excited, right? And so when the wise men came and when they saw the baby Jesus, they too were excited. They were excited before they even got there. And in fact, they were so excited that they knelt down and they worshiped him. So I want you to remember that Jesus is the greatest gift of all, that he came to love us, and he came to be with us, and he came to be our friend. And I want you to be excited about that, okay, and happy. All right, good job. So I think you can go to your Sunday school class. So today is Epiphany. I'm going to talk about what Epiphany means. I've learned a lot. My husband, well, he said to me last night, you've had a lot of fun with this, haven't you? And I said, yeah. So it may, some of it may be a little over your head, but that's okay, because we come to church and I want you to learn something. But I hope that you will have a deeper appreciation for what happened on this day and why we call it Epiphany. So with that in mind, we're going to stand and sing the next song, We Three Kings. I want you to pay attention to the verses. I'll address some of those verses as well. But imagine yourself making your way, making the journey to the Christ child. Let us stand and join together in our next song.
If you guys were looking in your bulletin, you'll see a time now called glory sightings. To some of us, that's a familiar term. We used to do it in some of our meetings and stuff. But what it is, it's we often don't give God the glory for the everyday little things that he gifts to us. So they're called glory sightings, or as our friend Wes Brown used to call them, glory sightings. So if you guys have a glory sighting, and I have some people that are going to give us some examples, but this is your time to share. And if you would just come up and come closer to microphone one. And Mike, if you can make sure that's turned on so people online can hear our glory sightings. So Rita's coming with one.
You're close enough. Just that microphone, just stand a little.
Okay. So our glory sighting is actually
Rita.
Go. Closer.
Mike, is that mic on? Mike, is the mic on?
That's it. Now I hear myself. Okay, so Sue and I actually share this glory sighting. Many of you know, maybe you don't, Jack's sister and brother-in-law were up, and they moved him to hospice in Nashville. Well, he had given them his car, and they needed somebody to drive that car because she can't drive for a long period of time. So Sue and I were going to
Bowling Green
to do a Frozen Four run.
Walk.
We didn't run. We did a walk, too. But so Sue said, hey, calls me and says, I got you into something. So anyway, I said, that's fine. She said, and at that time, she told him we'd take it to Bowling Green. They could pick it up in Bowling Green. So I call her back and said, Sue, we can take it to Nashville for them. We'll just leave the day before and take it all the way for them and bless them with this that they don't have to worry about coming up and picking it up in Bowling Green. So Thursday, got in the car and off we went. And it just, you know, just praising God for good weather, a good time, you know. It was a great time. And then we got to spend some time with Billy. We went to see her. So, and she loved it and says she misses everybody and hopes people will come and see her. Then we delivered the car to them, spent some time with his sister Janine and her husband, and then we went to visit Jack. And so, and then we went to my daughter who lives there and spent the night with them. So it was just a great time. And then went to our walk on Saturday, which we completed. Yay. So. It was just a good time. Felt like we were on the road a lot, but you know, it was good. It was good to have some time, spend some time together in the car, but to get to see all those friends and relatives too. So praise God.
Yes, definitely. Glory sightings all the way. I think I got to move over here so I don't vibrate.
Jim Ennis, a year and whatever ago, we joined this church, and shortly thereafter, our pastor had a vision, and she said, could we have chair volleyball at this church? And I said, okay, I'll get the stuff together. Well, I'd like to say hallelujah. Now 6 months into chair volleyball, we had a good turnout of all 12 people and a scorekeeper this past Wednesday, and everybody has fun. So come out and join us. Okay.
Glory. Is there anyone else that has a Martha? Who are you? Marilyn.
My name's Marilyn. How long have I known you?
I just want to say on Facebook, I think it was this morning, I saw something where a homeless man was sitting very poor and dejected on a train in New York. And an unknown person to him came up, took his jacket off, put it on this man who was obviously very cool. Having seen that, somebody else came up, got a sandwich out of their purse. and walked over and handed it to this man. This thing continued, and I thought, if our world could just be like this, we'd be heaven on earth like God wanted it to be.
Amen. Glory. Mr. Tom.
I feel like every week's a glorious Sunday just get to see all your people.
Amen, amen. Anyone else? Well, here comes Shirley. And you thought they wouldn't share.
Mostly everybody knows that my husband and I were sick through the month of December, and I didn't get to do things, bake cookies and different things that we always do, and I felt really bad. But since then, I've been watching Christmas movies and doing things that, to bring the joy back. And the thing I was thinking yesterday after I watched a Christmas movie, I thought, this is the way it's supposed to be all year. We're supposed to be with a smile on our face and joy in our hearts and know that God's there with us always. And he gave me the joy back that I needed, because when you're sick, you don't feel it as much. But I just wanted to thank God that, he watches over us and he gives us what we need when we need it.
Amen. Okay, I've heard that.
God is good, and you guys did a fabulous job. I was sharing with Sue, I said, normally when churches do this, at least in the churches I've been in, it's like pulling teeth. But again, I remind myself, Gail, this is not your typical congregation. They are wonderful. So thank you for sharing. And we're going to do this every week, God sightings. Because if we talk about joy and having Jesus in our life, we need to show that. And so God put that on my heart that we need to start and share our glory sightings. Amen?
Amen. Amen.
Praise him every day.
May I say another
and
thing?
Before, yeah.
The name's Meryl.
Dad Meryl.
So exciting, God's mysterious ways, because for a couple of weeks I've been thinking to myself, I'm going to get a plain piece of paper and I'm going to write down every day the blessings that I've been given and the good things that have happened to me. And I forgot it last week, and I was thinking of it this morning. So, and then you were saying this is going on, so
yep.
It's God's way.
Amen, amen.
You're never too old, right, to find something to be thankful for, to see the God sightings. All right, so we have a time now where we can give back unto God a portion of what we have received. So let us give joyfully of our tithes and our offerings. And let us think this week, how can we also be of service to others? Thank you.
You may be seated. I'd like to share with you the prayer cards that have come forward. Joanne has COVID, so keep her in our prayers. Tom Carr suffered a heart attack. Tom lives in Texas. Prayers for the Shad family. They lost their daughter last week. Prayers for Rodenheimer family for the loss of their daughter yesterday. May their hearts feel the comfort of God. Prayers also for another family that we know that lost the Lyons family. They lost their daughter as well. And then I received word this morning that Jack Arnold did pass away. So just got to Nashville. And then Janine just called me about 15 minutes before the service started. So that's the update. We'll miss them. All right. So the family will, you know, as I get more information, I'll be happy to share that with you as well. A celebration in the spring, Sue said. Maybe that's what, but that could change. But there'll be a celebration of life. All right. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, we start off the new year with a whole range of emotions, great joy and yet great sorrow. But Lord, that is a reminder of what life is all about, our ups and downs. But you did enter the world. As a child, as a human being, you understand how we feel. And yet you also came to be the Savior of the world, a light in the midst of such darkness. Help us today to understand how we are to worship God. We get so caught up with our iPhones, with the hustle of life, and yet we neglect to kneel and spend some time with you. Teach us this year how to worship you. With joy, with expectation, with a heart full of gratitude, and with service. Be with those today who are in need of your touch, who are in need of feeling your presence. We pray that you will comfort them, guide them, let them know, Father God, that they are not alone. Help us to be a light of kindness to all we meet. We ask this in your name and through the prayer that you have taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Our scripture reading this morning comes from the book of Matthew, chapter 2, verses 9 through 11. After they had heard the king, they went on their way, and the star they had seen when it rose went ahead of them until it stopped over the place where the child was. When they saw the star, they were overjoyed. On coming to the house, they saw the child with his mother Mary, and they bowed down and worshiped him. Then they opened their treasures and presented them with gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. The word of God to the people of God.
As I mentioned earlier, today is Epiphany Sunday, and Epiphany follows the 12 days after Christmas and falls on January the 6th. So it's always celebrated the closest Sunday to that date, and that's why we celebrate it today. It typically also marks the end of the Christmas season and marks the manifestation of Jesus Christ to the world. In fact, the word Epiphany means appearance or manifestation. It commemorates the visit of the Magi to the baby Jesus in Bethlehem. And as I thought about the scripture lesson for this morning, I was struck by several things. The first is the star. I can't help but ask the question, a star did all of this? I mean, think about it. How did the star direct the Magi from the east to Jerusalem? Where did the star come from? How could it last that long? Well, so I went searching on the internet, and I found a fascinating article written by David Weintraub, who is a professor of astronomy at Vanderbilt University. The article is titled, "Can Astronomy Explain the Biblical Star of Bethlehem?" So I want to share with you some things that that professor had written. Mike, will you bring it up? What about the star parked directly above the first creche? The word usually translated as stood over comes from the Greek word apano, which has also had an important meaning in ancient astrology. It refers to a particular moment when a planet stops moving and changes apparent direction from westward to eastward motion. This occurs when the Earth, which orbits the Sun more quickly than Mars or Jupiter or Saturn, catches up with it or laps the other planet. Together, a rare combination of astrological events, the right planet rising before the sun being in the right constellation of the zodiac, plus a number of other combinations of planetary positions considered important by astrologers, would have suggested to ancient Greek astrologers something important and unusual was about to happen, all signs of a royal birth. And then he cites the work of another astronomer, Michael Monnier. Astronomer Michael Monnier points out that in the East is a literal translation of the Greek phrase anatoli, which was a technical term used in Greek mathematical astrology 2,000 years ago. It described very specifically a planet that would rise above the eastern horizon just before the sun would appear. And then, just moments after the planet rises, it disappears in the bright glare of the sun in the morning sky. Astronomer Michael Monnier believes that the wise men were, in fact, very wise and mathematically adept astrologers. They also knew about the Old Testament prophecy that a new king would be born of the family of David. Most likely, they had been watching the heavens for years, waiting for alignments that would foretell the birth of this king. And when they identified a powerful set of astrological portents, they decided the time was right to set out to find the prophesied leader. The portent, I didn't know what that word meant. So here's what portent means: a sign that something momentous is likely to happen. So the portent began on April the 17th of 6 BC, when the eliacule rising of Jupiter that morning, followed at noon by its lunar occultation in the constellation Aries, and lasted until December 19th of 6 BC, when Juniper stopped moving to the west, stood still briefly, and began moving to the east as compared with the fixed background stars. By the earliest time the men could have arrived in Bethlehem, the baby Jesus would likely have been at least a toddler. So that, my friends, is how God, creator, all-knowing, all-powerful, works. Remember a couple weeks ago, the sermon, but God had a plan. But God works and moves in our life. But God guides us. But God, we can trust him. I hope you found that interesting. A star. With all that explanation, I don't understand it all, but I believe it. Amen? So let's turn our attention now to the Magi, or the wise men. Who are they? Nowhere in Scripture does it say that there were three wise men. And yet, every nativity we see, there's always three wise men. We actually don't know how many there were. And as I have mentioned, these wise men were probably astronomers. They were well-versed in astrology, and this was a highly esteemed science at the time. And according to the ancient historian Herodotus, the Magi were a tribe of people that descended from the Medes. From the Babylonian to the Roman empires, they maintained a place of tremendous influence in the Orient, and they served as powerful advisors to the royalty. So coming from the Orient, they were not Jewish, they were Gentiles. And more than likely, they were pagan. They were non-believers. But despite having a non-religious background, they also knew that the prophets had foretold the birth of a Jewish king born in Bethlehem. After all, they were trained professionals. And they read and they studied the prophecies of old. They looked to the sky for signs. They knew what to expect and look for. And we don't know how far they traveled, but they came prepared for the long journey, and they probably came in a caravan. And they did not stop at the manger. They did not stop at the manger. Scripture says that they made their way to Jerusalem, and they asked Herod, "Where is he that has been born king of the Jews? For we have seen his star in the east and have come to worship him." What struck me was they asked the question, "Where is he?" The very first question, "Where is he born king of the Jews?" You see, they came expecting, they came believing, they came hungering and thirsting for something so surprising. They came in awe. And after consulting with King Herod, the chief priests and the scribes, they are told the answer to their question, in Bethlehem, in Judea. And so now they make their way to Bethlehem and they see the star. And it stood over the place where the young child was. And when they saw the star, what did they do? Anybody know? They rejoiced. They rejoiced. And they did so with exceedingly great joy. When I read that, I have overlooked that time and time again. The first thing they did, they rejoiced with exceedingly great joy. Even before they got there, before they entered the house, they were rejoicing and they were filled with great joy. Before they got there, they claimed the promise. They claimed it for their very own. Sign after sign, miracle upon miracle, plants doing this and that, the sun casting their right reflection. Scripture and prophecies fulfilled just as it was foretold, everything lined up perfectly. And before they had knocked on the door to where Mary and Joseph and the Christ child were, they were filled with joy and they were rejoicing. Before they even got to see Jesus, they were rejoicing. Before they even got to worship Jesus, they were rejoicing. And before they even got to give their gifts, they were rejoicing. How many of us, before we even get to church, come rejoicing? How many of you, when you got up today, said, I don't know, it's too cold outside? Or what about this? I don't go to church anymore because I can stream it. How many of us rejoice before we write a check out to the church or decide how much money we're going to put in an envelope? In all these scenarios, do we rejoice, complain, or make excuses? Mike, I'm going to pull up the next. Oh, you got it. Okay. So the first thing the Magi did was that they rejoiced. And the second thing they did as they worshiped him, they knelt down. And when they came to the house, they saw the young child and they fell down and they worshiped him. Some translations say that they knelt down. And it was in that very moment that their lives changed. Dr. Billy Graham explains it this way. When the Magi saw Jesus, they had an epiphany or a sudden insight into the true nature of something they had longed to uncover. They had an aha moment. They realized that they were in the presence of God. They had been on the lookout for God, searching for him in Scripture, listening for him in the words of the prophets, and watching for signs of his revelation on earth. And now the discovery had been made. So I got thinking, how often do we kneel before our Lord and worship him? Do we long to truly be in his presence? I can remember as a kid kneeling by my bedside before I would pray. I don't do that very often nowadays. The only time I do it is when I'm weary or burdened and I don't see any way out. The only time I do it is when I need something. How often do we kneel to honor our Lord and Savior? So men, do you remember getting down on your knee when you proposed to your wife? As you knelt down, you did so out of respect and appreciation. You were honoring her. And do you remember the feeling of joy and excitement and anticipation and relief after she said yes? Perhaps we need to fall back in love with Jesus again. Perhaps we need to spend more time in prayer and devotion, focusing more on him rather than on ourselves or on our iPhones. And that's another reason why we're going to celebrate this year with God sightings. The third way they worshiped him, they offered up their what? Their treasures. Gold, the most coveted treasure, the standard by which all wealth was measured. Just like today, the price of gold dominates the stock market and our world's economy. It's a sign of power and wealth. And so the Magi offer this gift to Jesus because he is indeed the Messiah, the King of all kings. He is the one from the line of David. And the hymn that we sang earlier, written by John Henry Hopkins Jr., reaffirms the association of this gift to one of royalty. Born a king in Bethlehem's plain, gold I bring to crown him again. King forever, ceasing never, over us all to reign. Frankincense, a unique pungent aroma. Frankincense is a holy oil often used in the temple by priests as they perform rituals. It is important to know that only priests could make an incense offering. So even today, priests in the Roman Catholic Church mix frankincense into its incense and they swing it back and forth during the worship service. This gift symbolizes Jesus' divine nature as God's Son, who deserves our respect and praise. Jesus is more than a priest. He is all-powerful, all-knowing, and the one who saves. And when we think about the importance of these gifts and what they mean, it's interesting that in the book of Isaiah, when describing Jerusalem's glorious restoration, tells of nations and kings who will come and bring gold and frankincense and shall proclaim the praise of the Lord. That's from Isaiah 60. Again, John Henry Hopkins reiterates the significance of the symbolism so well. Frankincense to offer have I. Incense owns a deity nigh. Prayer and praising, all men raising, worship him, God on high. Myrrh. It too had a familiar association among the common person. But I am sure that when Mary saw it, she must have cringed and asked, why this gift? It isn't really appropriate for a young toddler. See, myrrh was an oil used for embalming the dead. It was a scent of bereavement. However, the day would indeed come when Jesus would be offered this gift again, and he too would refuse it. They brought Jesus to a place called Golgotha. They offered him wine drugged with myrrh, but he refused it. And then the soldiers nailed him to the cross. Again, from John Henry Hopkins Jr. hymn, myrrh is mine, its bitter perfume, breeze of life of gathering gloom, sorrowing, sighing, bleeding, dying, sealed in the stone cold tomb. I often wondered why, when we sang that song at Christmas, it ended on that kind of note. Now we know why. So as we start this new year, perhaps we need to be reminded of, again, how the Magi worshiped our Lord. First, they came looking, and they embraced the journey. They were hungry, and they were eager to search for what they were looking for. I'm excited for a meeting on Saturday. Where is God leading us? Where is God leading you this year? It's a journey I can't wait to be on. The second is that they came expecting to find something. They didn't give up. They had been told something amazing was going to happen. What is God orchestrating in your life? What do you need to let go of? Will you let God take and lead and set you on the greatest adventure of your life? Thirdly, they came with the right attitude. They were ready to worship and rejoice. And the fourth is that they offered their treasures. They offered their what? Their junk? Their used items? Their treasures. Are you being generous with your treasures? Are you tithing? Are you giving of your time and your talents? Or are you holding back? So I think it's ironic that these magi, these non-believers, these pagan people fell down with exceedingly great joy and worshiped the Lord. The unlikely of the unlikely fell down and worshiped the Lord. The Magi realized that Jesus was their king too. And isn't recognizing Jesus as king the ultimate realization that anyone can have? It is indeed a life-changing epiphany. So it's appropriate that we come to the table today to celebrate once again in the Lord's Supper, a life-changing event. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. It is right and indeed a joy to give you thanks, You alone are God, the source of all blessings. You alone brought forth your Son, Emmanuel, God with us. Born of the Virgin Mary, he lived as one of us, yet without sin. To the poor, he proclaimed the good news of salvation, to prisoners, freedom, to those grieving, comfort, and those carrying heavy burdens, rest and hope. Holy, holy, holy Lord, God of power and might, heaven and earth are full of your glory. On the night in which he gave himself up for us, he took the bread, gave thanks to you, broke the bread, and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body given for you." And then he took the cup, gave thanks to you, gave it to his disciples, and said, "This is my blood of the new covenant, poured out for you and for many for the forgiveness of sins." When we eat this bread and drink from this cup, may we experience anew the presence of our Lord Jesus Christ. Through these gifts given in love and sacrifice, may we be forgiven of our sins, redeemed by your grace, and restored into relationship with you. Friends, I invite you to come to the table. The table is open to all. Any can come forward. So the chairs. Normally when we take communion, there's an altar. We don't have an altar. And I know it's hard to get down and kneel and get back up. So I was thinking, how can we spend today maybe kneeling before our Lord? So if you want, you can come and take the elements and just kneel. Okay? Maybe get back up. There's be seats in the front. And if not, go home later today and kneel, fall down, and worship the King of Kings. What a great way to start the new year. Come and experience God's grace, God's love, God's forgiveness, God's salvation. Come. There may be times in which the organist will need to leave. She needs to go and attend her church service, and she's part of the choir. And I've said, that's fine. That's just fine. We're so grateful to have her. Yeah. So our closing song, Gail, I don't know if you know that. We're going to sing to a video, so you're good to go. And we're going to sing Majesty. So will you stand and let's close out the service with singing joyfully Majesty.
Your grace has found me just as I am. Empty hand above love and light. We're singing.
Changed by your love. Forever they were changed by his love. Go in peace, knowing that God loves you, knowing that this year you can be changed by his love. Amen. Amen.